All right, at 6:30, the appointed time, we appreciate everyone being here. If you could all stand for the prayer and the pledge of allegiance, please. Mr. Dale Smart of the Dawson County Tea Party is going to lead us in a prayer, and it's a very special prayer.
Almighty God, whose great power and eternal wisdom embraces the universe, please watch over all our sheriffs and deputies. Protect them in their everyday duties of serving papers, traffic violations, evictions, domestic violence, and more. Give them the strength to accomplish the difficult tasks that lie before them. Give them the wisdom and quick reactions that will result in the safety of the people and their community and themselves. God, protect these brave men and women, grant them your almighty protection, and please unite them safely with their families after their duty has ended. Amen. Can you join?
Attention.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Please be seated. And the prayer that Mr. Smart read was the assurance prayer. And so that was why it was very appropriate.
We're going to start with opening remarks. The first person will be Frank Sosby, then Jeff Perry, Jeff Johnson, and then Tony Wooten. Opening remarks to begin with. You have 2 minutes to offer your opening remarks at this time.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for coming. It's my pleasure to be able to stand here and be a part of this process. There's a couple of things I want to share with you tonight. As I've lived in Dawson County for this, it'll be my 32nd year. I married my high school sweetheart here. We raised 2 fine sons. One of them's here now. One of them's living in Troy, Alabama. I'm vested in this community. I have a desire to serve our community in a far greater capacity. For nearly 24 years, I've served in a true law enforcement capacity. Now, you're going to hear folks talk about experience. And what I want you to leave from here tonight is realizing what your sheriff's office is comprised of, what duties and responsibility. You're tasked with electing your next sheriff. And first question that we need to ask ourselves is, what does that experience entail? What does that position require? And I think it's very, very important that we need to educate ourselves as to what exactly your sheriff does. Are we electing a figurehead, or are we electing a sheriff, someone that's going to roll his sleeves up and go to work, basically? I grow tired of politicians that hold offices, and I assure you that I will not be one of those. I've worked patrol. I cut my teeth in the jail. I've had some good detention experience. I've worked patrol for numerous years. I've supervised and served in investigations in special assignments. I was over I served sometime in a multi-agency task force for a while. Ladies and gentlemen, your sheriff's office is a multifaceted organization. And ladies and gentlemen, I ask you today, tonight, to consider the experience that's required that goes along with this title. Ladies and gentlemen, I seek to serve you. I want to get involved as I get out and talk to folks. I hear their concerns. I see what they want. I hear their concerns about investigations, about being cared for. Ladies and gentlemen, I seek to serve in a far greater capacity. And as your sheriff, if you so elect me, I promise that I will be involved. Thank you.
All right, no matter what I do, I can't sit down. No matter what I do with last name W, I end up being last. I don't know how that works in life, but we always end up being last as W's. Yeah, Z's there for y'all. So, for me, you know, I'm Tony Wooten, by the way, in the sheriff's office. I've been here 18 years in the sheriff's office. I start my 19th year next month. You hear a lot of people talk about what they've done. You know, to me, you got to look at what, seeing the results of that, because too many times in elections, you hear promises. And you may hear those tonight with what I'm going to do. And I get tired of hearing those. Let's look at people's results and what they've done for the community. And that's what I feel like that we should be looking for as our next sheriff, is the person that's been out, that's been doing these things. People say that, I want to do this, I want to do that if I'm sheriff. But why haven't you been doing that for the last few years when you've been here? Why do we wait until the time? And I say this every election with the sheriff, every election with anything else that goes on. every 4 years, somebody steps up and says, hey, by the way, Dawson County, I love you. This is who I am. I know you don't know me, but I love you. You should know the person. You should be able to see that this person's been dedicated to your community, and I feel like that I've been that. As far as experience, you know, I've worked in every aspect. I started here in Dawson County 18, almost 19 years ago. I started at the jail. I worked my way to the top in several different divisions. I've been the division commander of every single division except for one in the sheriff's office. I think that's important. I believe on day one, when somebody takes over, they need to understand what the sheriff's office is. They need to understand day one how to take over the sheriff's office, how to run that sheriff's office. And I believe with my experience running your investigations and your patrol division and those things, that I believe I have that experience. Again, I ask for your vote on May 24th. Thank you.
We have 9 questions prepared for each of the candidates. First question, you will have 90 seconds, a minute and 30 seconds to answer the question to move on. And that first question is, how do you think the community views the role of sheriff? Mr. Johnson?
I think it's important where you're at in our country, how the sheriff is viewed. I think here your sheriff is viewed as a community protector. And I agree with that. And I think the sheriff needs to be open. He needs to be available to his community members. I think if they have an issue or problem, they need to be able to come to the sheriff. They need to be able to talk to him. But I also submit to you that I also believe that today's role, the sheriff needs to be a far greater than a community protector. We see what happened recently in Brussels. We see what's happening in California, the school shootings, the roadside shootings, things of that nature. Dawson County, we're approaching a new age. And if we think for a moment that it won't happen here in Dawson County, we're naive. And I submit to you that we need a sheriff that's going to be prepared, that's going to prepare his people for times such as that. Do I believe in community policing? You better believe it. I believe if our folks know you on a personal level, they're going to be more inclined to take better care of you. But I also believe that we need to prepare our folks for the future and for what's coming inevitably. Because, ladies and gentlemen, as sad as it is to say, Dawson County is not what it used to be. We have soft targets here in Dawson County. We know that. We realize that. We see the mall. What better place for an act of terrorism to occur? In Dawson County, I think we need to get serious. We need to start thinking ahead. We need to start get outside the box and stop thinking locally and start thinking on a national level as well. Thank you.
I think the sheriff is obviously
a leader, somebody that's a leader in your community, somebody that you know, somebody that you can trust. I don't take that word lightly, trust. I think that's something that you got to be able to do. You got to be able to trust the person that's going to be your sheriff. You know, everybody's got good answers up here as far as this. I mean, you know, I mean, Jeff's right, the fact that there's going to be, we have soft targets in Dawson County. We've been protecting those for years. I think every time you have a debate like this, you have people come out and start saying what they want to change about Dawson County, what they want to make better. You hear buzzwords like community policing that sadly haven't even gotten. People don't really understand what community policing is and a lot of people's aspects. They just say the buzzword because it's election time. I feel like the sheriff's office has done a good job. I feel like we live in a pretty safe community. Are we perfect? Absolutely not. We should strive every day to be better than we have been the day before. But we have a good sheriff's office. For the most part in here, most of us have never been victims of any violent crime. We don't have a lot of stuff that goes on in Dawson County. I want to keep it that way. The things we've done have been proactive that we've done in the past. I've reduced crime when I was the patrol division commander, investigations commander. I reduced burglaries to a low that's almost half of what counties, some of the counties that surround us are. And I'm talking about counties that are the same size, not the bigger ones. So we can do this by simply keep doing what we're doing and enhancing the programs that we've already got. I've already mentioned that I want to do a retail unit out there in 400. That's where our greatest issue is. In the last debate, somebody said that we shouldn't put more resources out there. In this debate, you just heard that we should put that soft target out there. So we got to keep doing the things that we've been doing, and we got to pay attention to where our soft targets are. We got to have the resources and the experience of somebody that knows what to do to stop crime. I've done it once. I'll continue to do it.
The next question, and we'll start with Mr. Perry. What do you feel are the two most challenging issues to safety and security to the citizens of Dawson County, and how will you address them? Mr. Johnson?
Talk about two of the most critical safety and security threats to our people. It's important that we not only define what they are, and in my opinion, I do believe that drugs are a huge problem in Dawson County because they are the catalyst of all other crimes, thefts and robberies and burglaries and murders and things of that nature. So number one, we have to get a good grasp on it. But two, we have to think collectively, what are our other issues and what are other problems? What are you most likely to be confronted with over the years? And you know, that can be a wide variety of things. We're starting now to see a lot of thefts, a lot of frauds coming into play. A lot of you may have been the victim of an attempted fraud. Those are things like that that we have to get a good grasp on in Dawson County. So how do we do that? How do we fix that? Number one, is your sheriff allowed me to wage the war on drugs? But then again, that's not a single person. There's not a one of us up here that can say that we're going to fix this or we're going to fix that. You know, only by the grace of God we're allowed to draw the last breath that we did. So we have to approach this thing realistically. Now, I believe it's a partnership. I believe that's where we get in partnership with our community. We start building that trust again. We start holding open forums. We start having community forums. We start having training. And we educate our public as to what we need to do to protect ourselves. We talk about issues. We talk about problems. We talk about active shooters and things like that. Ladies and gentlemen, if any one of you in here tonight are in the sound of my voice and putting all your trust in one man, I feel sorry for you. Because, you know, ultimately, we have a hard enough time taking care of ourselves. But that's where we have to take our resources and we have to take our capabilities and help educate our public, help educate those to make the right decisions, to look, to listen, to be vigilant, to be cognizant of what's going on around you. And ladies and gentlemen, as your sheriff, if you so choose, that'd be one of the primary things that we do. We want to empower our people. In this day of independence, in this day of entitlement, I think we need to get our independence back and our autonomy back. And that'd be a focus and a direction of mine. Thank you.
Mr. Wooten.
Okay, two biggest issues. First for me, crime is crime. Whether you talk about traffic, whether you talk about burglaries, crime is crime because it makes you a victim. One of the things that I want to see the U.S. respond with is a traffic unit. It's been a long time since Dawson County's had a traffic unit. It's the thing that we need to work on now. We had 14 fatalities last year in Dawson County. That's too many. Several of those were caused by drugs and alcohol. That's too many. The biggest chance that you have to probably get hurt by crime in Dawson County is traffic related. By people that aren't paying attention when they're driving or they're impaired driving. We've got to get a grasp on that. 400's coming up and it's coming quickly. The interchange is changing out there. We cannot afford to sit back on our hands and not do that. In an earlier debate, people said that they were going to turn it over to the state patrol. Sometimes you have one trooper covering three counties. We cannot, listen to me, cannot turn our problems over to other jurisdictions. You need a sheriff that'll stand up here and handle those problems head on, not pass the buck to somebody else. We can't do that. They don't have the resources, and we can't ask them to be our sheriff. We need to have a sheriff that can handle that. The second thing is to continue to build the community trust. Dawson County has that. That's why I've stayed here 18 years. I haven't been anywhere else. I haven't come from anywhere else. I chose to be a part of this community, and we've got to continue to build that trust. We got people moving in. We've got to invite them into Dawson County. I can remember a time in Dawson County that either you were from here or you were moved in. And that is somewhat merged now, and I want to continue to see it merge because we got a lot of good people that are from here. We got a lot of good people that have moved in. And we need to work together as a community to make this the safest place that we can live. I've got three kids at home. It's imperative to me to see us be able to do everything we can as a community. Our schools have to be safe. Crime has to be addressed at every single level. We can't do it monthly. Can't do it every 6 months. Has to be done daily. You have to look at things daily to see what's going on with your crime and how to stop it on a day-to-day basis. I love when people say we want to use the same thing to get the same results. Our results have been phenomenal. We had 72 burglaries 3 years ago. That's lower than it was when I started in 1998. We've been at the part we've had 150. Thank you.
Question number three is also a two-minute question. What are your top three priorities as sheriff, and how would you achieve them? To go first, Mr. Johnson.
Top three priorities, number one, is our drug enforcement. We've got to do a better job. We've got to do a more thorough job. We have a wealth of resources at our fingertips. We need to make a better, we need to do a better job of using those resources. In our jail alone, we have so many avenues, first to link individuals, first to monitor for conversations, things like that. And it is a wealth of information. Ladies and gentlemen, I told you earlier, that's the catalyst of most other crimes. So we have to deal with that. If we're going to reduce our exposure to other areas, we have to increase our drug enforcement efforts. That's number one. Number two, I want the officers back in your neighborhoods. You know, we talk about creating traffic enforcement units, things of that nature. Ladies and gentlemen, I've been in contact with GSP. GSP is more than welcome and willing to come up here and assist with our traffic enforcement. I'm not saying we push aside from the table off yet, but I'm saying that I'm more concerned about your families, about your home, about your personal safety than I am the roadways. I'm not saying we're going to turn a blind eye to our roadways, and we can't be reactive. We don't want our roadways to turn into raceways. We don't want them to turn into speedways. We don't want them to turn into fatalities. But our patrol officers can do a thorough and a fine job going from residence to residence, also enforcing the law. The third thing, we need to do some restructuring of our internal processes. Ladies and gentlemen, for too long, we focused on the wrong thing. We're focusing on quantity and not quality. And that's where a lot of our problem is. We've got to focus on quality. Ladies and gentlemen, if it doesn't have substance, if it doesn't have merit, we won't do it. I don't care about statistics. I've never been a statistic person. I've worked at agencies where, you know, we want to talk about business checks. We want to talk about residence check. Right through a residence, 30 miles an hour is not a residence check, I'm sorry to say. So don't tell me anything about statistics. I know how statistics can be padded. Ladies and gentlemen, if it doesn't have substance, if it doesn't have merit, we simply will not be done. Thank you.
Mr. Wooten?
Three things. First, obviously, crime. That's a passion of mine. I'm going to continue to say it over and over and over. I'm going to talk about that. Saying that things don't happen the right way, the statistics. Our burglary rate went down 36% in 3 years. 36%. That didn't happen by cars driving 30 miles an hour not paying attention. That happened from hardworking men and women going out there every day, doing everything they can to reduce our crime in Dawson County. These guys don't need to be shorthanded or cheated. They worked every day in the Dawson County Sheriff's Office to try to reduce that crime. And I'm not going to stand here and let that happen either. You know, to say that we want to be in your communities. My plan is the plan that puts officers in the communities. By saying you're going to have a traffic unit and a retail prevention unit that I'm going to have out there, I'm using the existing resources that we already have at the Sheriff's Office. They're not in the patrol division, not from investigations. I'm putting additional officers in the street. When those officers that are traffic enforcement are working traffic, and those people that are working retail, it frees up the officers that are on the shift to be back in your communities. But they can't be in your communities if we don't do something to add additional help out there, because they've got to respond to the calls that they get. We can be like Call County, some of those in the past that I grew up in, that they run from call to call. You can't prevent anything because you're going from call to call. We can't be that way. We have to get ahead of it. Drugs is obviously a big concern for everybody. Every agency, every county, every city, that's a huge concern for us, all of us. We've got to make sure we do a better job of that, better than we've even been doing. We've had a good drug unit. They've been very productive over the years, and we just need to continue to improve on that. The last thing is money for employees. I'm not asking for a tax increase. Let me say that a million times. We have 108 employees. I believe we have enough 108 employees. That's enough for the sheriff's office right now. I spoke again this week to the sheriff. I spoke to several people running for commissioner, and I'm going to make it clear over and over and over as a conservative until I feel like we've used all 108 positions the best way we can and did everything we can to fund those 108 positions. I don't need 128 positions if we're having to hire a bunch of idiots just to put them out there. That's going to be people that y'all are mad at because they're not doing their job right. I want to take care. Less is more sometimes. Thank you.
Question number four is also a two-minute question. Please prioritize the needs of the Sheriff's Department as you see them, and how will you address each need? 2 minutes, Mr. Wooten.
Can you say top four?
Please prioritize the needs of the Sheriff's Department as you see them, and how will you address each question?
Okay. I'm going to continue to say basically the same thing we've just said. It's probably going to be a lot of the stuff that you hear on this one, too, the top priorities, and some of them, this stuff is right. I mean, we lose people in and out of jail quite a bit. I mean, that's, you know, I'm not trying to knock Jeff Johnson on that end. It's a training ground for officers to come into the jail. They start out. Some people like law enforcement, some people don't. We live in a society right now where, I mean, cops are being just ridiculed daily. If you don't believe me, ask me. I was on the news just a week or so ago. So I understand what it's like to be in that situation. So we have people that don't want to be in law enforcement anymore, and we've got to change that as a community, as a society. That's got to be one of the top things that's got to be done. We're not just losing people because they're going to find other jobs. By the way, I don't know anybody that's went to Johns Creek. I'd like to hear the name of that person. I've been here 18 years, and the only one that almost applied to Johns Creek that I know of was me a long time ago. So we've lost people in different counties, and yeah, we just lost a few that are friends of mine. One that just went to a private sector job that's making about twice what he was here. How do you stop that? I mean, we're not going to be able to pay twice as much, y'all. This happens in business every day. Businesses don't continue to pay like they do. They don't. You can't do that every time. Thank you. I'm not through. Sorry. I'm just thanking you because she stepped up. The biggest party, though, I still think we have to get a hell of the growth. The growth is coming. I've seen it during my time. When I first started here, I didn't even know Dawson County was a county when I drove through it the first time because there was nothing here. I mean, there was just nothing. 400 was a drag strip, from what I understand, years and years ago, as a road that led to nowhere, according to a lot of people. But we got to get ahead of that growth. And I've been a part of that growth. I've seen what we can do as a sheriff's office. I've seen what we've done already as a sheriff's office to prevent the crime that's going on now, that's went on before, because we've had worked hard. You hear everybody up on the stage say one of the top things they want to do is reduce crime. I appreciate that, because I have done that along with the men and women that work here. We've done that. Can you imagine trying to stop less than 6 burglaries a month countywide? That's almost impossible to be everywhere. But we've done it to where 6 a month. And we got to continue to work hard, continue to work with our commissioners to try to fix the fact that, like I said earlier, we got to try to pay our people a little bit more money. We got to try to keep them. Thank you.
Mr. Johnson.
The priority and the needs of the county are direct, or the sheriff's office are directly the needs of the people. And the reason I say that is simply this, is that what affects us in the sheriff's office ultimately affects the people in our county. And that's where we have to be very, very careful. Obviously, there is a staffing issue. You know, first to say we're going to create this division, we're going to create this and create that. The latest staffing study showed the department to be about 40 officers short. And so I'm not sure where all these different positions are going to come from. But I'll say this, we need to make absolute use of the officers that we do have there. Now, how do we retain officers? One, I think it's through leadership. I think it's through inspired leadership. And again, how do we change that? It's a different day and age. We come, and now it's a society of where I wanted it yesterday, where we grew up, our mom and dad grew up, that we knew that we didn't earn things. You know, we might have got a new car when we were in our 40s or in our 50s, you know, and so the mentality's changed. But I'm not saying that the mentality's lost. I think we need to do a better job of focusing back and strengthening our recruitment, strengthening our application process. We need to find folks that are truly, absolutely suited for public service, because it is a commitment. It's tough. Jeff Berry said it a while ago. When an officer has to go to court, when they get called in to do this, when they have another duty, our staffing is short. Our staffing is in need. It stays in need. But I think we can do a better job with what we do have. I do believe in employee retention. So how to retain employees is your sheriff. I will remain involved in sheriff. I'm not going to be a disconnected sheriff. I've devoted too many years to investigations. And when I say experience, I encourage you to verify people's experience. Don't sit up here and let me tell you that I've done this and I've done that. Verify the information. I've served for years in investigations. I will stay active with your investigations. I will stay active with your patrol department. I think that we have a wealth, but it's got to be one of those situations where we lead by example. And as your sheriff, I promise you that I will stay involved and I will stay in with our folks. Thank you.
Okay, question number 5. This is another 2-minute question. I'll read it twice because it's a little lengthy. A bill under consideration in the Georgia legislature would require an individual receive a criminal conviction before civil forfeiture action results in the liquidation of seized property. Do you support this bill? And I'll repeat that. A bill under consideration in the Georgia legislature would require an individual receive a criminal conviction prior to or before civil forfeiture action results in the liquidation of seized property. Explain your position. Mr. Johnson.
And I concur. There's no room for debate, in my opinion, on this matter. We have to make sure, first of all, we need to also understand that your sheriff's office is not a revenue-generating entity. It's a service. It's a public service. And I think we need to be careful. We need to draw a fine line when we're approaching things like that. Do I believe in seizures? Absolutely, I do. But also, again, I believe in the court system. And again, your sheriff's office is a post-adjudication. Your sheriff is concerned with enforcing the laws and the services of Dawson County. You know, we're not concerned with innocent or guilt. We're concerned, that's the court's job. That's the jury's and the court's decision, is to decide if someone's innocent or guilt. Your sheriff's job is to enforce the laws, to enforce them fairly and enforce them impartially. As your sheriff, I agree with this and I concur with this, that we do not need to seize anything until that person is found guilty in the eyes of the court, and then we can move forward with the proceedings. Thank you.
Mr. Wooten.
I love standing on my own because I'm going to disagree wholeheartedly with all three of you. When we've done asset forfeitures, you keep saying the court system. We have a court system for asset forfeitures now. We don't just walk in and say thank you for your stuff. There's a system in place already. If you go back and start saying, we're going to wait until we convict people, people in this room that know how the court system works, that could take years. So what are we going to do? I want some money from some of you that are going to be commissioners, because if I win, we're going to need storage facilities for these things for years. We're going to need places for the depreciation of these cars and houses that aren't going to be worth anything by the time they actually get through court to be found guilty. There's already a program in place. It's already there. We already have asset forfeiture rules that we follow now. It goes to the court system. They can fight that then. You don't have to wait until somebody's been found guilty for asset forfeitures. You're going to give a green light for the drug dealers. They're going to love that bill when that passes, by the way. They're going to be excited about the fact that they're not going to have to worry about losing their stuff right off the bat. And what is the sheriff's office going to do? I hate to put birds out of business, but I guess we're going to have to open a storage facility for the sheriff's office, because we're not going to be able to do anything with our stuff. We're going to have to house it forever. I don't know how else to say that we cannot change that law. I hope that you fight that tooth and nail. I mean, it's just crazy for me to walk in, do drug deals that we've done. We've got recorded lines with people saying that they've sold drugs, and that's how they've gotten the money that they've gotten done things with. And we're going to tell them, you get a pass for 2 years. I guess sometimes I believe I'm too conservative, but I believe you got to punish the people that do stuff like this. We can't say we're going to sit back and wait for you to be found guilty. There's a process in place. It goes to the court system right now, and we need to continue to follow that process. We can't be a holding facility. We cannot be a place that sits back and worries about the depreciation. I mean, these drug dealers are smart now. They drive, sometimes the cars are a piece of junk now, because if they get caught, they don't want to have to lose anything. By the time we get it, we'll have to push it out of the parking lot. So we'll be, I don't know what we're going to do with any of this stuff. It won't be worth anything. Drug dealers are going to love us if we pass that bill. I totally disagree with it. Sorry if I'm wrong, but I'm going to go to the grave on that one. We cannot continue to reward criminals in this country.
Okay, question number six has a number of parts to it, and I've been asked to let the audience know that each of the candidates received some information that was provided to them to review in preparation for this next question. And then the question to all four of the candidates, were you able to review the information provided regarding Sheriff Richard Mack's position? Mr. Sosby?
Yes.
Mr. Johnson?
Yes.
Mr. Perry?
Yes.
Mr. Wooten?
Yes.
Okay, so everyone received the information and had an opportunity to review that. The first part of the question then is, the information that was provided by Sheriff Richard Mack, what stood out the most to you? And you've got a minute and a half to address that. What stood out the most to you, Mr. Perry?
Let me just try to do a little background on this for you. Some of you don't know. Sheriff Richard Mack, he was the sheriff in, I believe, Graham County, Arizona. And while there, he was a very pro constitutionalist, believed in the Constitution wholeheartedly, and the NRA used him to file a lawsuit against, it was Mack v. Arizona, but it bordered on the Brady Bill, that certain aspects of it violated the Second Amendment. Now, if you go back and you look at anything I said or anything that I've done, I support the Second Amendment. And I said this over and over, and you go back and read what I said, I would not support any federal authorities who come in here to try to submit to Dawson County and try to arrest someone on, which is enforce an unconstitutional law, which is the Second Amendment. And that's what Sheriff Mack wrote about. And he said, he wrote a book, it's a pamphlet actually, he said, and the title of the book is Sheriffs, America's Last Great Hope, meaning that the sheriff is really the highest office in the county, and they have the authority to resist anything that's unconstitutional, be it federal or state. They're sworn to uphold the federal U.S. Constitution. They're sworn to uphold the state constitution and state law. And so that's what Sheriff Richard Mack is. He's very supportive, a constitutionist, which I say I am a constitutionalist. I believe in the Declaration of Independence and the Constitution and the Bill of Rights.
Thank you. Mr. Johnson, what stood out to you?
In Prince versus U.S., Prince versus United States, what we have is they challenged a portion of the Brady Bill, basically requiring them or forcing them to to do certain background checks, and so they were victorious in that. One thing I believe in, and I'm a steadfast pro-amendment period. I don't care which amendment it is, but especially the Second Amendment. I believe so many men and women died for that right. And as your sheriff, and we constantly, and we still, we've held classes, you know, informing and educating our public as to what they can carry, when they can't carry. And, you know, if you ask me my personal opinion, I'll certainly give it to you. I think there's too many laws on the books regarding our firearm carry right now. But that's neither here nor there. We can only affect what we can. As your sheriff, and what came out about this court case, too, is that they want to argue, and again, there's two sides to the equation. And basically, it's put as the sheriff is the supreme law in the county, and he's the chief law enforcement officer of the county. However, some people on the other side will debate. You know, I believe it's Article 6 of the Constitution said that they'll uphold federal law. So again, that's a debatable issue. But I say this, as your sheriff, I assure you that I fully stand in support of our Second Amendment rights, as I do all of our amendment rights. We've made too much progress. We've come too far. To let a next sheriff come in and take those from you. We need to continually be teaching our people, empowering our people, educating our people on what they can and can't do. Number one, to empower them, to keep your family safe, to keep you safe, and hopefully to strengthen us together as a community as a whole. Thank you.
Mr. Wooten, what stood out to you?
Richard Mack, if you don't know,
is a sheriff that obviously they said was pro-guns, and everybody on the stage is going to say that they support the Second Amendment. I believe everybody on the stage does support the Second Amendment. The problem, I think, with Sheriff Mack is he may went just a little too far with a lot of stuff that he believes. He believes in no gun control. So does anybody in this room believe that if you think you're a terrorist, you should just be able to walk in and buy a gun and not have a background check? I don't. I believe that we should do background checks for people because you have mentally unstable people that are going to buying guns and committing crimes. I believe you have terrorists that are among us that have come in through our borders for many years, and we cannot just say no gun control. That's just not a thing that we can do anymore. I think that he starts out like a lot of citizens. I believe he starts out tired of the federal government putting their hands in our business with everything that we do. And I do think that most people feel that way. But I think you can't go to the other extreme either. Some of the groups that he's associated with was going to go to Rowan County, Kentucky, not far from where me and my father-in-law dear aunt. Over there from the lady refused to do the marriage license. And if that sheriff in that county, if that judge would have found them guilty, they were going to go in and keep that sheriff from stopping her from being held in contempt. We can't go the other way either. This guy can't be a part of a committee that's going to travel the country telling other sheriffs what they're going to do either. So I think that he's frustrated. I think a lot of us are frustrated. I say the tax season is upon us. Nobody pays the federal government more than I do in April. So I think it's something that we're all frustrated about, but I don't think that we can go the complete opposite of no gun control either. I think we've got to support the Second Amendment. I would do that as your sheriff. I'm not going to let people come into your county and take guns. I don't believe that's possible. I don't believe it's going to happen anyway. We're coming to take it.
Thank you. Mr. Johnson, in regard to Sheriff Mack's positions, would this influence any decisions that you make as sheriff?
Not that on itself. And again, to explain that further, I believe in your Second Amendment wholeheartedly. I will say this, that I think we need to use reason and logic when we do everything. So anytime any federal agents come into the county, obviously we need to have that common courtesy. We need to be able to have that dialogue and that cooperation and that partnership. And if you think, well, the feds can't come, the feds are already here. There's a slew of federal programs that's already in place that you and I are already exposed to and privy to. As your sheriff, I can promise you one thing. I believe that we've overdone it with our laws and our gun laws. And I don't care how many laws you make or how many laws you create, there'll still be those that just don't care, those that's going to circumvent it, period. So the more we create laws and the more we create laws, what are we doing? We're hampering the law-abiding citizen. We've seen it at the rash of the Newport, Connecticut shooting with the permits that were issued. We had just an influx of folks coming in to get their permits. And I jokingly made to one of the folks that was there, and I said, I don't think I've seen the first criminal come in to get their permit. So basically, there's too many laws in place. We're hurting ourselves, we're killing ourselves with these laws. And as your sheriff, I can promise you this, if there's any right infringing laws or potential, whether it's a county ordinance, whether it's a state law, as a sheriff, I promise you I'll be in their ear. Thank you.
Mr. Wooten, with regard to the Sheriff Max position, would this influence any decisions that you make as sheriff?
Yeah, let me clear something up. I said I don't believe that they can come get your guns. I still stick by that. I think if you look, you'll see that the way they're controlling gun control already is through ammo. I think there's ways that they can do this, and I know there's people in the room that can make their own ammo, but for the most part, most of us can't. So I think they're already controlling our firearms through ammo. It's hard to get a lot of times, and that's the reason. I think it's just them controlling the ammo. Does his stuff affect me? I think that, you know, at the end of the day, we both, all of us up here, whoever gets this is going to be sworn to uphold state and federal laws, everything that we already have talked about. At the end of the day, though, when you see things like the fact, if somebody tells us we're coming into Dawson County, we're going to take the firearms of the landowners in Dawson County, it will be the place where civil war begins. That's not going to happen in Dawson County. I don't see anybody lined up to give them their guns. I'm not giving my guns up. I can tell you why, because I have three little boys at home and a wife, and the only reason that we've had wars on other people's turf instead of the U.S.'s turf is because we believe in guns in the United States. And they've said before, the reason you don't attack America is there's a gun behind every blade of grass. And we got to keep that here. We got to make sure that stays here. But most importantly for me, I think you got to be willing to walk away. If federal law passes to the point that I get told that I'm going to enforce things that I don't believe that are against my convictions and against the First Amendment, Second Amendment, whichever amendment it is, at some point you have to be willing to say, I'm not going to do this job anymore. This job has not defined who I am. I have convictions and ethics that are much higher than being your sheriff, and that's being a Christian first, and that's being somebody that cares about our protection of our safety second, and I'm going to fight for those. That'll be, if I have to stand up and leave, then I'll stand up and leave.
Okay. Question seven is a change of pace from where the type of questions we've been asking. It's more of a question about your personal character. Everyone can identify a defining moment in their lives, one that changed their outlook on life in some form or fashion. What would be your defining moment and why? You have a minute and 30 seconds to answer, Mr. Johnson.
Well, that's an easy one. And I'll say this, I know there's supposed to be a separation of church and state, but let me share this with you. As a 7-year-old boy, I surrendered my life to Christ. And it was profound. I knew that I was lost, and I knew that I was dying, and I knew that I was going to hell. And as a 7-year-old boy, I surrendered my life to him. Now, for those that know me for a long time, and you can ask my wife, I've been far from perfect. But I'm thankful that I'm forgiven. And that's been the most defining personal event in my life, by far more than anything. There's been some other proud moments that I've had. Obviously, I've married my high school sweetheart, and we had two fine sons. My oldest son is now a pastor in Troy University. I went to Troy University as a pastor, youth student minister at Southside Baptist Church there. Lovely wife, married a Gainesville girl. Got my youngest son back here. I have my sweet mom in the audience with me tonight. So I've been blessed to live in a simple home. I grew up under simple, loving mom and dad, and life was simple, but it sure was sweet. And thank you.
Mr. Wooten.
Like Jeff said, that's an easy question. So obviously when you got saved, you might have been a little luckier than I was to do it at 7 years old. I think that I was one that didn't grow up in church, and I think that helps me a lot because I was I grew up as a young adult trying to do it my way, and I found out that that's not easy to do. Your way is just not going to work out. It didn't work out for me. So the best part of my life, obviously, is when I gave my life to Christ and I realized that it's His will. And that's... You know, it's simple for this. I know this is an election. I know people wear different people of church. But at the end of the day, I think everybody on the stage simply wants what God's will is. If it doesn't come from His hands, I don't want it in mine. I feel that way about the sheriff's race and every single thing that I do in my life. If I have to go work at Ingles, or I actually like working at Walmart, I can probably do a greater job. So if that's what I get called to do, that's what I'm going to do. But for me, it's easy. Easy answer is simple. That it's obviously the day that, you know, Christ came into my life and changed my life. Thank you.
Question number eight, this will be 2 minutes. As sheriff, you will be in a position of leadership. Leadership is characterized by a display of emotional intelligence, integrity, vision, and a motivation that creates an environment of personal influence. In your new job as sheriff, how will you successfully demonstrate these personal traits to be viewed as a leader that the department will follow? Mr. Wooten.
think one of the things...
As being a leader is obviously, you know, the first thing for me that pops in is being willing to be out there with the people that work for you. And people see, you gotta lead by example. I don't believe that you can lead from the bottom up. I believe you have to lead from top down. The person that accepts this role, whoever the citizens vote for, you gotta be able to lead this community and this sheriff's office. You know, I believe that, you know, when I was over patrol in CID, one of the things that I think that I did well was I got involved. There was many nights, going back to one year at New Year's Eve, I answered the first call of the night. Me and my partner turned out to be a guy that barricaded himself and took his own life. I was the major. I didn't have to be out there, but you have to be out there. I may not be, as your sheriff, I'm not going to be sitting behind a desk. That's just not who I am. You've seen me at ball games. You've seen me at park stuff. You've seen me. I think you lead by being an example. I think you lead by being involved. I think you lead by helping the troops when they need help. I've worked patrol as a captain, a major. When we were short, I went out there and worked. And you have to, that's when you have to roll up your sleeves. Everybody has to get their hands dirty. You can't just simply say we're going to go ask the commission for more and more and more. Sometimes you're going to have to get your hands dirty, and you're going to have to go out there and help. And that involves everybody at the sheriff's office, not just the people that are out there. Not just the five that are on patrol, but everybody in the sheriff's office. I think leadership means that. I think you've heard people that continuously say that, you know, they believe this or they believe that. Three of the four of us on the stage have a take-home car from the county sheriff's office. If you believe so much about stopping it, turn the ignition and go help. We all have a car. We can get involved in this. That's what I think you look for, somebody that's willing to go get out there and get involved, not somebody that just talks about what they're going to do. We hear too much of that going on now with politics. Promises, promises, promises. I think we should look at what people have done in the past, see the results they've gotten. I love that we keep talking about crime reduction because that's what we've already done. So I feel like it's a pat on the back. And hopefully those who are going to view this tonight see that everything's going pretty well in Dawson County considering that crime's dropping like crazy. Everybody says that's the most important thing. So I thank you. I ask for your vote on May 24th. Thank you.
Johnson. Ladies and gentlemen, the greatest resource that we have in Dawson County across the board, whether it's sheriff, whether it's fire, whether it's public works, utilities, is our people. And how do we inspire? How do we lead? Ladies and gentlemen, again, I don't want to echo what the other candidates have said, but obviously we need to lead by example. We need to be there. We need to be mentors for our people. We need to help guide them, lead them, direct them. You know, we can sit up here and say we've got the experience, we've got that experience. And ladies and gentlemen, I've devoted my life, my entire professional life to law enforcement. Been in the trenches. I don't hold a title. A title is useless without, is a title without substance is fruitless. And a title to me doesn't mean a whole lot. Ladies and gentlemen, I've been there with men and women. We'll continue to be so. We've got to inspire our people. We've got to encourage our people. We've got to take more care of our people than we do our cars, than we do of our building, than we do of our other facilities. We can have the finest cars, we can have the finest facility, but if we don't have the quality men and women to staff those, to put out there. And ladies and gentlemen, I don't think you're real concerned whether it's a 2016 Dodge that pulls up in your driveway or whether it's a 2010 Dodge that pulls up in your driveway. But where your concern is and where my concern is from your, as your sheriff will be, how do they treat you? Are they properly trained? Are they adequately trained to help you with your time of need? Because ladies and gentlemen, when you call 911, you don't get your choice of who's coming out. You want to get a representative of the sheriff. So as you make your decision, I encourage you, who do you want coming out? What kind of representation do you want coming out? And ladies and gentlemen, I know this to be true, and I was told this from an old cop years ago, a shift will always be a reflection of its supervisor. A department will always be a reflection of its department head. And in your sheriff's office, will always be a reflection of your sheriff. So as you go to the polls and you think about that, who do I want coming out to assist me and helping me in my time of need? Thank you.
Okay, our last question kind of takes us from the objective to the subject. And we're going to hear the bottom line from each of you. The question is simply, why do you want to be sheriff of Dawson County? You have 2 minutes to respond. Mr. Johnson.
Thank you. Why do I want to serve as sheriff? The answer is simple, it's a commitment to serve. Ladies and gentlemen, I've ran on the campaign the slogan, your office, your sheriff. I truly believe that from the bottom of my heart. I'm not seeking a title, I'm not seeking power, I'm not seeking notoriety. I could care less about that. We've dedicated our career to law enforcement, to trying to make a difference in the lives of others. As the sheriff, working as the sheriff's major, we've never faltered. We've never abandoned our position. We've never given it up. We've always stayed the course. We've endured a lot of difficult times. And I promise you that, we've enjoyed a lot of rewarding times. We've enjoyed a lot of successes. Ladies and gentlemen, there's more to do. There's a lot of work to be done. And I think the key to that is building partnerships with each of you. And regardless of whose shirt you're wearing today, who you're supporting, I can promise you this. If I get elected your sheriff, I'll treat you with the same optimal service that I will with these men and women supporting me out here today. Ladies and gentlemen, this is about service. This is not about anybody up here, but this is about our community. This is about our county. I grow tired and I grow weary of elected leaders holding positions and just to hold positions. You know, whether it's power some people want, whether it's money, whether it's retirement, whatever the case may be, I grow weary of it. And I don't make promises for fear that I may not be able to keep promises. But I make a pledge to you that as your sheriff, I'll be an involved sheriff. I'll be a working sheriff. And you have that commitment from me. It's about the people. It's not about me. It's about the people. Thank you very much.
Mr. Wooten. Service. It's easy. Servant leadership. That's the only kind of leadership I believe that there is, servant leadership. You know, servant leadership is not an 8-to-5 job. You don't go home at 5 o'clock. Most people that are in this room, I said in the last debate too, that you've seen me out and about. 18 years in Dawson County, fixing to start my 19th year. I've been a part of many, many programs that have gotten started in Dawson County. I've ran those programs in Dawson County. But it's more than just an 8-to-5 job. I remember a kid that I was thinking about today over the years because, you know, I mean, unfortunately, when some of us may lose this, we may not be here anymore. So this may be all for a couple of us on the stage tonight. Maybe my last chance to tell you how much I appreciate working for Dawson County. But I was reflecting today on the things that I remember about the things that I'm thankful for the sheriff's office. I remember the two kids that lost their moms in the same year. Two different kids, both lost their moms. And me and another officer took them to Turner Field, and we paid for everything that day to give those kids an opportunity to do something they weren't get to do in a year that's been tough. When we were ready to shop with a cop, when Walmart came, I was knocking on the door before they got the building up, wanting to shop with a cop here to take care of the kids that are in need during Christmas time. I started programs through our church to feed kids that are hungry. That when people talked about, oh, our kids are eating out of the trash can, I did something about it. I didn't stand and talk about, yes, we should do more. I went out and figured out a way. When we do a Christmas project every year at our church, third year in a row we did, and it's grown tremendously. This year we had to go out. Thank God Birds helped us at the mini storage. We had to get a U-Haul for all the toys we took out on Christmas Day. We partnered with other churches. That's servant leadership. It's not the talk. I'm so sick of hearing people tell you what they're going to do if they get something. Why haven't you been doing that already? That's servant leadership. You shouldn't have to wait until you can come into a room and say, guys, if you elect me, I will do this. You should be able to look at that product and say, have you already been doing this? And to me, I believe that I have. We've been doing instrumental stuff with kids and citizens forever in Dawson County. I can tell you I've got a letter from a lady not long ago when her husband died in a car accident. She lost her unborn child. I threw a basketball tournament at Dawson County High School with surrounding counties, and we were able to raise money for her needs. That's servant leadership.
Thank you.
We now come to the closing remarks. We're going to take the candidates in reverse order from the opening remarks. Each of you will now have 3 minutes to summarize what you have said tonight or provide any other closing remarks that you might have. 3 minutes, and we will start with Mr. Wooten.
I get to go first for a change. The last names, feel good about this. You know, for me, it's simple. I go back to, I've said it a million times, and I'm going to keep saying it. It's been my passion. I believe that you need to look for somebody that's passionate as your sheriff. I don't believe you're going to look on the stage and find anybody that's bad. Nobody here is somebody that's not going to be able to hold this position if you elect them. I think all of us are going to get everything that we have. I think it's simple. It's who do you think that's best, that cares most about the community? I believe that's me. I believe I've shown that for the 18 years. It's not just that I have the heart, it's that I have the experience that goes with that heart. I've been the commander of every division but one. I worked that division when I first started out. I've been everything that you can possibly be in the sheriff's office to make sure that I'm prepared for this. I've moved around different positions to get the experience that I need, that if I choose to do this one day, that I'd be ready to be your sheriff. I feel like the day that I walk in the sheriff's office that I am prepared to take over that. I've ran patrols. You know, one of the endorsements I got lately that means the most to me, my wife can tell you, I actually started crying when this lady sent it to me. 7 days we searched for these two kids a few years ago. You'll probably remember that. 7 days. I was the patrol division commander, the investigations commander, the public information officer. I met with the family daily, made sure that us and the GBI worked together every day to make sure that we worked together and got along, which is a challenge sometimes. to make sure everything that went well for that. But when this mom sent me an endorsement letter saying, you are the right one for the job, that didn't turn out well. That, like, we found that lady in the lake. But for 7 days, relentlessly, I worked that case. I was the first face she saw every morning. I was the last face in the sheriff's office she saw every night. That's the commitment that I believe that you need as your sheriff. It's not an 8-to-5 job. I come in, we're having a revival of our church. I couldn't even stay there because I know this lady's lost her kid. Her kid is lost right now. She doesn't have an answer for where her kid is. Both moms, both dads don't know where their kids is. I can't just go home and say, what's on TV? I'm not that kind of person. I'm the person that's going to go out. We're going to turn over every stone that we can, and we're going to find ways to be able to prove and give those answers that we need to those people. And I think that's the experience that you need. You need somebody that can say that they've led those kind of things, that they've been in charge of investigations, that they've been in charge of patrol. You can't just simply say, I've done that. We've got new people right now today that just started. They've done that. They're not ready to be your sheriff. You can't just simply say, I've done that. I think the most important thing is to say, I've led that. I've already shown the success. You heard on the stage today, everybody's talking about crime reduction. I appreciate that. Like I said before, we have reduced crime. You heard people talk about gangs. And I'm going to tell you, one of the persons sitting here can attest to this is Johnny Holzclaw. We've had kids that come into our school system that tried to start gangs in Dawson County. We ran them out of Dawson County. That's why you don't have gangs, because we've been doing stuff. Not because we've been sitting around talking about what's going to happen, because we got after it then, and we'll continue to get after it if I'm elected sheriff. Thank you.
Mr. Johnson.
Ladies and gentlemen, your sheriff is tasked with providing certain duties and responsibilities. And there's a Georgia code that lays them out. It's running a jail. It's running civil processes and serving civil processes. It's in jurisdictions such as ours that are smaller. It's about providing patrol enforcement services. Ladies and gentlemen, and I wouldn't say anything bad about a community program because I'm involved in a lot of them. Ladies and gentlemen, you're electing a sheriff. You're electing someone to enforce the laws of this county, to treat people right, to treat people fair, to treat people with respect and dignity. Ladies and gentlemen, the liability is far too great for us to risk. And what I mean by that is simply this. In today's society, it's a very litigious society. And as law enforcement officers, we have certain duties that we execute. Anytime we put our hands on someone, we have seized them in the eyes of the court. We have to justify that seizure. And that means that hopefully we're mature, hopefully we're making good decisions, hopefully we're making them with probable cause, hopefully we're making them in accordance with state law, with case law, such as that. Ladies and gentlemen, you're tasked with finding a sheriff, someone to lead your department for the next 4 years. I'm all about community programs. I believe them. I support them. But there's a bigger picture at play here. This is law enforcement that affects the entire county as a whole. And ladies and gentlemen, I submit to you, I don't claim to know it all, and the day that I do know it all, it's time for me to go. It's time for me to step aside and let somebody else have the reins. But I've been fortunate. We have progressed. I've spent my entire career in a patrol capacity, in a supervisory capacity, serving, commanding investigations, patrol, specialized multi-agency task force, things of that nature. I've spent my career as a teacher, as an instructor. I've spent time trying to teach and educate and help. You've all heard the saying that the best teacher in life is experience, and I believe that. Ladies and gentlemen, life's a hard teacher sometimes, but thankfully that we've learned from them, that we've been able to apply them. Ladies and gentlemen, you're going to elect a sheriff, and this sheriff has got to be a representation of the people. He's got to be a representative of the people. And he's got to make the wise decisions to keep us out of liability, to keep us from getting exposed to liability. Ladies and gentlemen, I pledge to you this. I ask for your vote. I ask for call me. If you have questions, if you have concerns, my education, my training is all an open book, and I'll be glad to share it with you. But I ask for your prayers, and I ask for your vote on May the 24th. Thank you.
I'd like to now introduce Ms. Sharon Keating.
Wow, that was fantastic. Let's give our candidates a big round of applause. Um, thank you very much for taking your time to come out and inform us. We really, really appreciate it. And as it was expressed numerous times, the best voter is an informed voter. And have a safe drive home, and we look forward to seeing you again. Thank you.
Uh-huh.